What we're doing here is we're encouraging everyone towards giving reason a fair hearing. You know, until we do that, we can have a million different universes and we'll still be wandering in misery, insecurity, futility. But by giving reason a fair hearing, we're able to wrap all that up and say, oh, now I see what I've been doing to myself, really. We've been just putting ourselves through this training program that we designed. We call it a quote-unquote universe. It's really a training program that we have designed to try to develop the ability to destabilize perfection to the point where perfection is no longer able to conceal the so-called flaw we believe it's hiding from us. So we can then fix the flaw, and then we believe we'll be able to have a glorious experiencing of the idea of being prior to perfection. That's all that this is. And this comes from giving reason a fair hearing. Giving reason a fair hearing. So the way to give reason a fair hearing is to just be neutral. Neutral. Be neutral. That's what I did starting out for sure. I just neutral. I said, okay, it's only fair to pay, you know, give you fair hearing. So you can, you know, convey what you want to convey, and I will just say, okay, I've heard it. I'm not judging it one way or the other. I'm not saying this is right. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying, okay, I heard what you said. Thank you for sharing this with me. So it's a very objective, fair hearing sort of thing where I don't have to believe what I'm hearing necessarily. Say, well, I don't know if it's right or wrong. I'd say, well, I don't know if this is true or not. And I don't know if it's true or not, but I'm willing to allow reason to present its case to me. That's all I did. It's only fair to allow reason to present its case. Now, logic, which is the one that's protecting this training program so we stay loyal to it, is like a defense lawyer or whatever, how you want to put it. It just fights tooth and nail to allow us to have give reason a fair hearing. It absolutely obstructs in every possible way. It has infinite obstruction tactics. Infinite. That's why we shouldn't try to just piecemeal go through each tactic and examine it, logic examine it. We've already spent untold, so long listening to logic, allowing logic to present its case. We haven't listened to reason at all. So what kind of fairness is it that is only completely one-sided, only listens to logic, not to reason at all? Is that fair? And I said, that's not fair, because it just simply doesn't, it's not fair. Let reason talk. If it's wrong, it's wrong. Okay, if it's right, it's right. But how will I really know unless I actually listen and hear what its case is? So it's presented a very, very compelling case. It certainly has. And I'm like, wow, I don't regret it at all, giving reason a fair hearing. It can be tiring because it's kind of shocking. It's like, wow. Truth is so different than what logic has presented to us. You know, logic keeps telling us it's presenting the truth for us. No, it isn't. It's absolutely disguising the truth, camouflaging it, covering it up, giving a false narrative, actually. It tells us this universe is our home. You know, this is our one and only home. And not true at all. This is a training program we have designed to train us to try and develop the ability to destabilize perfection. Okay, destabilize perfection. That can never happen. So all of us have exactly how much ability? Zero. Zero ability to do this. We're all equally futile. Equally futile. Zero gradations in that futility. Zero gradations. Nothing to judge. Yes, yes, yes. So there's a great practice to use. Equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 just equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 just equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 just equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, yes, yes. Like that. Just practice. I did that, practiced that yesterday. But it can produce You know, I had just a terrific day yesterday, and this morning was tremendous practicing, just non-locatable by universing. Wow, yes, yes, yes. Just non-locatable by universing, yes, yes, yes. So it was tremendous, best practice ever, but I'm exhausted today just from, I think, the shock of breakthrough. So you will have times when you get tired. There's no question about it, because you're putting in really diligent, difficult effort, because we're so familiar with what logic has been telling us that when we hear something different, it's kind of stressful. We say, wow, you know, I haven't been following the truth, actually. You're like, wow, logic has been fooling me. That's its job. We gave logic the job. We made logic. It's part of our training program. It's like a trainer, and this trainer, all it does is lie to us. It just continuously lies to us and telling us this training program is not only entirely necessary, but it will be entirely successful. Both of those complete total lies, and also says it's well, I said completely necessary. It's mandatory. Say it's mandatory. And will be totally successful. Complete total lies. So this trainer that we have designed, along with this training program, the trainer is called Logic, and all it does is lie to us and deceive us. But it's so good at that. It's so good at that. We're so used to it. It's quite a shock to see it. It's quite a shock. Even, I'm still shocked by it. It's like, what? Yeah, and I've been through innumerable shocks of recognition, and today I'm feeling really tired and sluggish, like, wow, I don't feel so good, whereas yesterday was the opposite. So you can have, your ups and downs, ups and downs, ups and downs. It's not easy to listen to reason, to give reason a fair hearing, because logic tries to obstruct it in every possible way. Absolutely, it does. That's its job. The job of logic is to make sure we never, ever, ever, ever listen to reason. Can you imagine that? That's the situation we're in. Because if we listen to reason, we'll realize, oh, we don't need to do this. It's entirely voluntary, and there's no possibility of ever succeeding at it. It's just a silly whim on our part. So there's no reason to keep struggling with that. Let's just judge that there's nothing to judge. Here, there's nothing to judge. Equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 just equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 just equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 just equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 just do that. And what do you need all that Tibetan headdresses and exotic dress? This is better than that, isn't it? It's got to be. This is wilder than anything Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lo Dron. He used to travel with like all these cases, 200 cases of hats, and stuff like that. Yeah. I got more than 200 hats, or maybe about the same number of hats, They're just a little more easily nestable. But I think Jamyang is probably saying, wow, that's nice accoutrement, what do you need? Tibetan Buddhism, we have this, woo! We give reason a fair hearing here. Giving reason a fair hearing, and that's a discipline. It's a discipline. Equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 just equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 just equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 just equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 nothing to judge, nothing to judge, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 nothing to judge, nothing to judge, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 nothing to judge, nothing to judge, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 nothing to judge, nothing to judge, nothing to judge. Yes, 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 like that, you see. That Jamyang would like this. He's probably here in spirit, like saying, wow, this is cool. I love this. Should I? Absolutely. Why not? Everybody's welcome here to tune into this, wherever you are. Tune into this. Equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, yes, yes. You see, like that. That's powerful. That's extremely powerful and helpful. And this comes from reason. It comes from reason. So I ask reason for practices every day. Says, ask for a practice. And I get a practice every day. I get a practice and then use it throughout the day, so I become proficient at that practice. And there's a lot of bumps along the road as you struggle to try and remember this and do it. And it's difficult. The practices are supposed to be challenging. And they are. Yeah, but by the end of the day, you know, probably you've grooved it pretty well. And now it's just like, it's easy. Equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes. 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 It seems like second nature, right? Well, it wasn't starting yesterday morning. I just got this practice yesterday morning. I was struggling with it all day long, you see. But not just a day later. Seems totally normal and natural for me. So that's how the path goes, is you do have to put in the practice. Otherwise, you're not going to become fluent, so to speak, feeling this fluency, you know, about it, fluency. You won't. If you just hear it, say, okay, I heard that. Okay, well, that's a fair hearing. I'd like to hear it, yes. And then reason will say, you know, it'd be much more helpful for you if you are learn to repeat these over and over and over, so it becomes so familiar to, like, friendly. You're on friendly terms with it, you might say. It's a way of getting on really friendly terms with reason. Is to repeat what reason tells you. That makes, you know, that's reasonable, to get on friendly terms, because we've been on very unfriendly terms with reason for so very long. In fact, we have, logic insists that reason is the is the cause of us not of our failure to develop the ability to destabilize perfection. It's reason that's holding us back. A total lie. Okay, total lie. How can we be held back from accomplishing the impossible? How can there be something causing us to fail to do the impossible? That's completely absurd, isn't it? So logic is just peddling absurdity to us in very clever, disguised ways. Absolutely, it's the absolute, you know, it's absolutely superb at that. That's what we designed it, logic, for. So it's a born liar. And that's all it does, it almost seems like, well, it must be true if that's all it does. And no. If we design something to lie to us, that doesn't make it true. It doesn't make what it says true. Okay, and we can't learn to love lies. Yeah, that's ridiculous. Everybody's here trying to learn to love. You can't love futility. You can't love lies. You know, you can't love fear. You can't. No. Love reason. If you want to love something, love reason. I love reason. Love is love at first meeting, you know, with me, with reason. It's just like, wow. It was just, you know, I was completely at a dead end, because all I realized that logic, all it had done to me, life after life after life after life after life, was lie. All I've been told were lies. That's all. And I said, well, I had no idea where to go for truth. No idea. Felt just completely at loose ends, entirely so. And then I asked for help, and that's when reason showed up and says, I'm here to help you. Okay, I will help you, and I will stay with you, and I will clarify everything and free you from your mystery. And I knew that this was true. Reason was certain that it could do this. It was different than logic. And so right away when that happened, I said, yes, you know, let's do it. And reason said, it's going to take a while. It's going to be a lot of work. It's going to be a challenge, a lot of work, but we're going to get it done. And I said, let's go. Let's do it. And that was quite some time ago. So still working on it. But that's simply because logic, we're so super used to it, that it's just set up like, you know, endless booby traps, you know, endless ways of tripping us up. And we have to, you know, get past those and realize, okay, that too is just another clever lie. And all lies are equal lies, you know. Logic tells us some lies are less lies than others. No, that's not true at all. It's another lie, isn't it? Some lies are better than others. Some lies are more true than others. No, all lies are equally untrue. All lies are equally untrue. All lies are equally untrue. Yes. Try that. All lies are equally untrue. All lies are equally untrue. All lies are equally untrue. Yes, yes, yes. All lies are equally untrue. All lies are equally untrue. All lies are equally untrue. Yes, yes, yes. All lies are equally untrue. All lies are equally untrue. All lies are equally untrue. Yes, yes, yes. So this is reason, you know, sharing with us. All lies are equally untrue. How great is that? That's lovable. Okay, that's lovable. To hear that all lies are equally untrue, got to love that. So A Course in Miracles has a lot of reason in it, a whole bunch of reason, along with a whole bunch of other stuff that's, you know, designed to motivate us and keep our attention and help us get engaged and try to lead us, you know, to giving reason a fair hearing. But my experience was it was an internal, direct reason introduced itself to me directly. I had been with A Course in Miracles for about 3 or 4 months at that point when it happened. Reason introduced itself directly to me. So there's been this inner relationship with reason going on continuously since then. And so A Course in Miracles just reaffirms, you know, this. It helps, it reaffirms. And Jesus put a whole lot of reason in there. A whole lot of reason. Terrific reason. So A Course in Miracles is helpful. It is very helpful. It's not as helpful as having a direct relationship with reason. That is for sure. And you can call reason the Holy Spirit or the grace of perfection if you want to. I call it reason because it reasons with reasons, right? You know, all lies are equally untrue. All lies are equally untrue. And that's just like, wow, love that, you know. Gotta love that because logic will give us infinite variations to try and confuse us on this issue. That's its job. That's what it does. It's our own creativity. And creativity doesn't run or get tired and run out of steam. It continuously, you know, keeps saying, well, how about this lie? You know, but surely that's not as much of a lie as this one over here. You know, they can keep doing that forever, you know, forever. Creativity doesn't die. You can't kill logic. Logic's just our own creativity. The idea you can kill the mind is ridiculous. That's just our own creativity. We can't kill our own creativity. It's impossible. Can't even kill the ego. It's all ego, mind, logic, lies. It's all the same. You can't kill that off. You can't purify it. We designed it to function the way it has. You can't purify that. It'll always be a 100% liar. And you can't kill it because it's our own creativity. We can't kill our creativity. That would incapacitate perfection, right? So what we have to do is we just praise it and exchange it. So we say just praising and exchanging logic for reason. I need do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. Just praising and exchanging logic for reason. I need do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. Just praising and exchanging logic for reason. I need do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. Just praising and exchanging logic for reason. I need do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. So we certainly do not want to hate logic at all. In fact, we want to really praise it and have this really positive feeling, not love, you know, but praise, praise, praise. You know, we're not pretending that we love being lied to constantly. No, but we praise the fact that it's our creativity and the fact that this creativity just never gives up. You see, that means our creativity is endless. It's eternal. Okay, so just praising and exchanging logic for reason. I need do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. Just praising, exchanging logic and reason. I need do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. Just praising, exchanging logic for reason. I need do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. Just praising, exchanging logic for reason. I need do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. So I do these 4 times, introduce it once, then do it 3 more times so that you can say this along with me. It's helpful if you say along with somebody. You know, initially, it can be very daunting task to practice in this way because logic is just looking at you like, you're crazy, you're crazy, you're crazy, you're crazy, you're crazy. No, it's logic that's crazy. Saying that some lies are more true than others is crazy. Saying that there's some way to do the impossible is more promising than some other way is crazy. Totally so. Right? saying that their gradations to zero is crazy. So everything, logic is crazy. It just presents craziness to us in attractive ways, you might, supposedly attractive ways, seemingly attractive ways. But the craziness is always there, you see. So it's like packaging. It's the expert packager logic. It just keeps repackaging. And same old lies, you know, same old delusion. It's exactly the same always, but the packaging is constantly changing. And even sometimes not changing, as if, oh, okay, so if I don't change the packaging, then you'll believe it's true. There's no way to do the impossible, whether no matter what the packaging is like. Just real plain packaging. It's good at plain packaging, too. You know, it is. It's, minimalist packaging here must be true. Maximalist packaging here, it must be true. You know, this kind of stuff. No, lies are lies and lies never are true. Lies can never become true. So since lies can never become true, they're all equally lies. But there's no such thing as a lie that's partially true. Okay, truth is entirely true. Always entirely true. So saying that it's not entirely, always entirely true is a total lie. You can't say, well, truth is like almost entirely true. And that's less of a lie than saying it's like total, truth is not true at all. No, it's exactly the same lie. It's exactly the same lie. Equally untrue. The truth is perfection is always perfect. To say that it's not always perfect is a total lie. It's to say perfection is imperfection. And then the gradations in that lie are meaningless. Meaningless. You see, once you say that perfection isn't true, you're stating a lie. And then trying to say, well, you know, it's not as much of a lie as saying that the perfection is like half false. I just said it's only a little bit false. No, you have negated the whole idea of perfection by saying that some of it is not true. That it's not true. It's not perfect then. So logic is constantly playing these games with us, constantly playing these games. And it's very daunting to try and deal with this because it never gives up. It can't. We keep thinking eventually it'll give up. It's our own creativity. Our own creativity, again, can't quit, so to speak. We can't quit creativity. It's what we are. That's our functioning. So you got to praise and exchange. So that Jesus also said this. That's the way to do it. Praise and exchange. Praise and reason told me this before I was aware that Jesus had said this. And reason said, look, the way to do it is to praise and exchange. Yeah, that's a reasonable way to go about it. And I read that Jesus in Dialogues on Awakening with Tom and Linda Carpenter, Jesus did say that the right way is to praise and exchange. Don't fight yourself. Don't condemn yourself. Don't, you know, this is your creativity. Okay, so just praising and exchanging, logic for reason. I need to do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. Just praising and exchanging, logic for reason. I need to do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. Just praising and exchanging, logic for reason. I need to do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. Just praising and exchanging, logic for reason. I need to do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. So it's these are nice days here. I wish I felt better. Longest day of the year is coming up pretty soon, isn't it? You know, what's a couple days from now? Strawberry moon, full moon's coming up right at the same time, kind of thing. That's interesting. But I feel so terrible, you know, as I can't do anything. But at least we can sit here and, you know, encourage everyone to give a fair hearing to reason. So just don't believe it. Don't have to believe, okay, this is true or this is false or whatever. Just hear it. Just hear it. Just hear it. Just hear it. So I studied A Course in Miracles for 15 years really intensely. And I just gave it a fair hearing. I didn't say it was true or not. I just wanted to know what is being said here. Okay, I want to know what's being said here. I want to be sure that I've given a fair hearing to what is being said here. I said, I can't quite understand what it's saying necessarily. Is this true or is it not true? But I want to, you know, it's only right to give it a fair hearing because someone's making a huge effort, you know, on our behalf, supposedly. I'm saying, listen, this will be really helpful if you give it a fair hearing. And seeing that logic has only lied to me, you know, forever, I said, you know, what have I got to lose, you know? I already knew that logic's a total liar. I didn't know where to go for truth. I said, this might be truth here. Of Course in Miracles, it might be. I don't know. But, you know, let me give it a fair hearing. So I did. And, you know, you just be neutral. So I just trained myself to just be in a neutral state. Read this. Don't respond pro or con. Don't respond pro or con. Don't elaborate. And elaborate means don't go to pro or con on this. Just hear it. Get used to it. At least that removes a familiarity bias from the situation. So you're used to it. And I still have, you know, I don't study Course in Miracles anymore, but I could go back to it at any point and look, you know, read it, and sometimes, not very often, but I can do that. I mean, I could actually do that. But it would still be kind of, you know, a little bit, it's a lot of words. We're kind of past the wordiness of the whole situation, you might say. Just yes. That's more helpful than reading this entire book, is just saying yes. This just is basically stating that perfection is perfection. If you can do that, you don't really need this book, okay? But it's very difficult to get to that point, because logic will try to interfere in every last tricky way so you don't do this. So it's, of course, it's very simple, but we leave out the fact that logic is trying to distract us away from doing this. And it's extremely clever and complex about the configurations and tricks it uses to distract us away from the simplicity. So it's not easy to practice simplicity like this. It is not easy at all. And we're not talking about lifestyle simplicity here, okay? The logic, that's another thing logic uses to trick us. It says, well, work on, you know, having a simple minimalist lifestyle. You know, living in a cave, you're living away from civilization, do all these things, all right? You know, and spend all your time doing all this stuff when you could have been practicing yes the whole time. You see how it wastes our time like this? And then eventually you're tired and you say, gee, I still have nothing, so I don't really feel like I've gotten there yet. And logic says, well, maybe you're on the wrong path, and let's go back to civilization. And it just keeps playing these games with us, you know, endlessly. So the way to cut through all of that delay, and again, the logic is absolutely, completely brilliant in delay. Okay, don't think you can beat logic when it comes to this type of delay games. You can't. But what you can do is you can just practice like this. You can just say, well, you can say whatever you want to logic, it's fine. It's like praise and exchange logic or reason. But I'm just gonna say yes. I'm just gonna do that. Okay. So we're not an adversarial relationship with logic. We're praising. Praise whatever you want to do. I've already praised it. You know, all praise to logic, but I'm going to practice like this and then just do it. So it takes this sort of will, you know, to see it this way. You're not trying to shut logic down. You're not trying to attack it, you know, or do anything to it. Okay, just leave it alone. So you can do whatever tricks you want to do. I'm not, you know, paying attention to those right now. I'm just practicing yes. That's it. And logic, you got the power over logic, really, like this. And, you know, it'll just, you know, it can't stop you from practicing like this. It keeps telling you it can, but it can't. So when you do this, you'll be shocked. You'll say, wow, I did it. I didn't know I could even do that. Logic told me I couldn't do that. Or something terrible would happen. No, nothing bad happened. So it could take you a lifetime to just be able to just get to this point of just saying yes. Or you could just do it right now. You see, you could save yourself a lifetime. You could. You absolutely can. So I'm encouraging everyone to save yourself a lifetime or many lifetimes of just you know, just extreme futility, struggling with logic and changing your circumstances, constantly trying to change your circumstances or whatever, right? Or you could just say yes is 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 yes right now. Just say that. Nothing bad's going to happen. You know, you say, well, nothing bad happened. Your logic said everything. No. And so you could save yourself lifetimes just by doing it even once. You're going to save yourself lifetimes just to prove to yourself you can do it. Because logic says, nah, you can't do that. Nothing to see there. That's ridiculous. That's not going to help you. And things, stuff like this. Oh, yes, it will. Because it blocks all the logic's tricks. It can't get a hold of you when you're doing this. It can't get a hold of you. So you feel free from this oppression when you're saying yes is 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 yes yes is 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 yes yes is 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 yes. You're feeling free from the oppression of logic and its tricks. You're free. And for maybe 15 seconds there, you're free of it. It can't grab a hold of you. And you say, oh, wow. So gradually you get used to being free of the oppression of logic. You know, it's trickiness. It can't get a hold of you when you're saying yes, 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 is yes, is yes, is yes, is yes, is yes, is yes. It can't do anything to you. So you have to experience these moments like this, and where you just, you know, logic is not able to, you know, work you over. You know, it can't work you over when you're doing that. And so the more used to that you get, the more prone you are to being willing to listen to reason more and more and more, and go towards just finally realizing equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, yes, yes. And then we have this gently gracious feeling of equanimity that's flawless, this flawless feeling. And then we realize, well, since I'm experiencing this flawless feeling, perfection must be flawless. There must be a flawless perfection. There has to be. That's a perfection. It's flawlessness. So I'm experiencing flawlessness. There must be flawlessness. So that means I can be reconciled with this flawlessness. It's very simple. It's very simple. Very, very simple. But again, logic never runs out of creativity, you know, right? I mean, you have to praise and exchange it. You can't purify logic. What do you mean purify logic? What's that mean? What, you purify lies? How can you purify a lie? A lie is never true. What does that mean to try and purify a lie? Yeah, it's ridiculous. You can't turn logic into a truth teller at all. That's impossible. That would be changing, separating an effect from its cause, so to speak. Right? Desire is the cause. Logic and the training program, which includes logic, is the effect of that, of desire, the idea of desire. Let's have the idea that there's a flaw in perfection that we can locate and fix. That's an idea. So the effect of that is logic, you know, and this training program. You can't purify it. It's not defiled. You know, some teachings say that, you know, that the problem is defiled emotions, defiled. They're talking about logic. It's just this trainer or the encourager of us to stick with this training program. That's what it is. That's what it does. You can't change that. You cannot change logic. You cannot rehabilitate it at all. Any belief that you're rehabilitating logic is another lie. Any belief that you're changing logic is just another lie of logic. That's why Rama Maharshi came to me in a dream and he showed me something. And I said, Rama, I'm really close. He said, no, that's the problem. Believing you're close is the problem. Logic will tell you you're really close. In other words, you've really changed logic a lot. You've really, really, logic will say, wow, you've rehabilitated me, almost done rehabilitating me. That's the ultimate lie, isn't it? Logic will say, you've almost finished rehabilitating me. Wow, that's the ultimate lie right there. There's no way to rehabilitate logic. Just praise and exchange. Don't rehabilitate, praise and exchange. Don't rehabilitate, praise and exchange. Don't rehabilitate, praise and exchange. Yes, yes, yes. Don't rehabilitate, praise and exchange. Don't rehabilitate, praise and exchange. Don't rehabilitate, praise and exchange. Yes, yes, yes. Don't rehabilitate, praise and exchange. Don't rehabilitate, praise and exchange. Don't rehabilitate, praise and exchange. Yes, yes, yes. Don't rehabilitate, praise and exchange. Don't rehabilitate, praise and exchange. Don't rehabilitate, praise and exchange. Yes, yes, yes. Great practice right there. And that's the key. Rama said, that's the key. And I said, no, Raman, I'm so close. He says, no, that's the mistake. That's the key mistake. Huh? He pointed out this to me in a dream. A dream visitation by Rama Maharshi. I was like, wow, this must be really important. So I kind of argue with him there. You know, I presented my case. I said, no, I'm really close. He says, no, that's the delusion. What, are we close to making a lie true? We're close to separating an idea from its effects. It's impossible. Can't make a lie true, that's impossible. Close to doing the impossible, close to rehabilitating logic. There's no close to it at all. You're equally zero progress. You haven't gotten anywhere in that regard. So you can't purify logic. It's not possible. So if it's not possible, how can I say I'm close to succeeding? Rama said, No. You're not close to succeeding. You're not close to doing the impossible at all. How can you be close to doing the impossible? So Rama Maharshi, really, that meeting, that visitation during a dream, was extremely crucial for me. Extremely helpful. I don't know how long ago that was. It wasn't that long ago, maybe a year or so, you know. It wasn't that long ago. And it was so crucial. And it took me a while to kind of like, you know, what's he saying here? What's he saying? What's he saying? And now it's becoming, you know, more and more and more and more and more clear. You know, it's really helped open up reason to me much, much more, because I was caught in that trick of thinking, you know, I've made so much progress in rehabilitating logic. It's almost rehabilitated. Well, who's telling me that? Logic itself is saying that, right? Logic will say, wow, you've done a great job rehabilitating me. You've almost completely rehabilitated me. That's a total lie. You see that? But it's a false hope lie, isn't it, of logic? False. It specializes in false hope. Specializes in lies of all types. But false hope lies is one of its great specialties. It says, wow, you know, you've just about finished rehabilitating me. You've almost saved me from lying. Don't try to save lying from lying. Just praise and exchange. Just praise and exchanging lies for reason. Logic for reason. Just praise and exchanging lies for truth. I need to do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. Just praise and exchanging lies for truth. I need to do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. Just praise and exchanging lies for truth. I need to do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. Just praise and exchanging lies for truth. I need to do nothing else. Yes, yes, yes. So that was like super intervention, super grace from the guru, the Maharishi, the great Rishi. Super, super, super grace. Like, wow. So I stick with Rama Maharshi in my life, you know, absolutely. You can't exclude him, you know, under any reason or whatever. He absolutely deserves a seat at the table. You know, he deserves the seat at your table. If you have a table, a round table or something, you got the table. Rama Maharshi deserves a seat at that table, period. No ands, ifs, or buts about that one. So, you know, I'm not always, you know, gung-ho about you know, everything necessarily, but he certainly always deserves a seat at the table, and he has stepped in two instances, pivotal instances, and helped me greatly in visitations during dreams. The first one was when I was feeling like I'm not saying exactly what he said, and I felt like maybe I need to just quit, and you know, if I can't say exactly what he said, I should just quit. And he came in a dream and then came up to me and said, you know, hey, I'm totally aware of what you're doing, and what you're doing, I love it, it's fabulous, keep doing it, just what you're doing, don't worry at all that it seems to be a little different. He says different times, cultural times require, you know, different, slightly different emphasis, etc. It's perfectly fine. You just stick with it. It'll be extremely helpful. Extremely helpful. And so from that point on, I really, you know, totally accelerated all in on just this huge, huge push. That was about 20 years ago, a little more than 20 years ago, might have been 24 years ago or so. But that was a pivotal moment there, pivotal moment. He said, yeah, just keep doing what you're doing. It's going to work great. So we're going to work terrific. Very, 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 very helpful. You know, so these visitations of grace happening at crucial points in time, like Sri Nan Mai Ma really saved me in 1997, stepped in, and I felt like I was just, you know, just I didn't have anything more in this world, really. I couldn't get anywhere. I'm just, you know, that's it. And then she stepped in and said, hey, you know, why don't you let's become friends, you know, let's become friends. And I said, wow, okay. This seems like someone I might would want to become friends with. She really just invited me into friendship with her. And I said, wow, what an invitation. This person's like incredibly, exotic, so I don't know what even you can't even say, you know, just amazing, whatever, and inviting me to be friends with her. And I said, wow, let's work at this, you know. And so that really gave me a reason to keep living at that point, because I was developing a friendship with her. I was working on the friendship, still am. I'd like to touch bases with my dear friend, Sri Nan Mai Ma. It'd be great to touch base with her anytime at all, you know. She's got a seat at the table also, absolutely does. Jesus does too, of course. Of course, a miracle saved me back in 1978, yeah, where nobody was willing to listen to what I had to say about you know, truth and reason and what's going on. This is a training program. And so I just like, it's just imploding, you know. It's just too difficult here, forget it. You know, I was going to just say forget it, you know. Not getting anywhere, going in reverse, you know, this kind of thing. And then the Course in Miracles stepped in and says, here, let's train you a little better here. Let's get real solid training going here. And I said, wow, okay. So, you know, when things get really bad, as they often do in this world, and then, of course, Buddha Longchenpa stepped in 2013, where I just felt like, you know, again, I was just wasting my life, really, not getting anywhere. He stepped in and then brought my, you know, real discipline training to me, real discipline training. Again, offer of friendship there. He says, well, I got an opportunity to be friends with a Buddha. Wow. You know, it's like, holy cow, this is an opportunity. And I didn't let it slip away. I'm still working on it, you know. Well, we're at a crossroads again in this world right now. With this, you know, this, we don't really have a country in the United States anymore, because they really don't have a culture anymore. You know, cultures produce countries. Countries don't produce cultures, really. We don't really have a common culture in this country anymore at all. It's split, you know, 50-50, basically. And we're just going, you know, farther and farther and farther and farther apart. We're going in opposite directions. So you don't have a country under those circumstances. You don't. Everybody feels very defensive. So I was just talking to some friends, Hispanic friends of mine today, and you know they have extremely robust family structure, extended family structure. And so he said, we always got together every single weekend. We'd have a big gathering at someone's house. And because there was always a birthday, there's always an anniversary, there was always somebody be turning 16 or somebody graduating, some reason to celebrate. They always, and so it just, we always were together with our friend, relatives and friends, etc., every single weekend. And that was true. I know that. And then he said, you know what now? Nothing. Nothing. He said, nothing. He said, even back in Mexico, nothing. I said, what? You kidding me? He says, no. Nope, stopped. He said, what do you, I said, how did that happen? He said, what do you think caused that to happen? I said, wow, that's shocking. I was stunned to hear that. And he's stunned too. He says, what in the heck? We've lost our culture. And he said, you know what it is? Smartphones. He says, you know what happened? We would go to these gatherings. Everybody was on their smartphone, just, you know, they weren't even talking to each other, hardly. We even visiting. We weren't even playing together, joking, and camaraderie together. No, it was all just, you know, dopamine hits on their, you know, smartphone. Dumb phone, you know, whatever. And so they've lost their culture. He says, we don't get together anymore. We don't even know each other anymore. You know, we don't interact anymore. He says, but culture's been destroyed. So global culture is being destroyed by technology. It's being destroyed. And they claim they're giving us something so much better. Oh, really? Well, you know, it is what it is. So we're using this technology in the best possible way, which is encourage us to give a fair hearing to reason. Okay. So reason doesn't just quit because things are tough. You know, it can't quit. It's its job is to introduce truth to us, introduce, you know, the truth of perfection to us. But the smartphone thing is decimating culture. But the U.S. culture is so divided on so many issues, and people feel so strongly about it. You know, it's just, we don't have a common, culture means commonality, where you just can trust that people you meet have a common core, okay? A common core value system. We don't have that here. We don't have that here at all in the United States. It's not a country because it doesn't have a culture anymore. It doesn't. You may feel, you know, okay with half the people, but the other half of people think you're the devil. You know, what kind of culture is that? That's not a culture. That's a divide. That's a divisiveness, not a culture. So divisiveness has been introduced into the United States, and it's getting more and more and more divisive by the day, by the minute. You know, they just raised $50 million. It's going to be all-out total blitz campaign, you know, propaganda campaign by one side, you know, towards the, you know, the verdict in New York, the Trump verdict in New York. They're going to put a $50 million blitz to point out just how terrible and evil he is, this kind of thing. He's a crook, you can't elect him, and stuff like that. And so half the people think that like, for instance, the verdict in Trump verdict in New York, 85% of the Democrats say that the verdict was totally justified. Totally justified. They totally agree with it. 85% of the Republicans believe that the verdict is not justified. Don't believe it, don't accept it, don't believe it, you know, it's not correct at all. So, extreme divide there, you know. So you can't talk about any of this stuff because people are going to get furious. So we're living not in a culture, but in a process, persecution. You know, you feel persecuted here. You know, because your views, you feel that people want to persecute you for your viewpoints, having any viewpoint at all. Someone's bound to want to persecute you for that. Didn't used to be that way. Used to be, we had this common core of common sense, common value. You know, people breaking into your home, bad. Okay. Criminality, bad. Okay. Stealing stuff, bad. Okay. Nobody would say it was good back when I grew up. There wasn't one person in this country that would support all the stuff that's going on right now. Carjackings. Anybody support that back then? Zero. The stuff that half the country supports now, back then, 0% supported it. Zero. You never had to worry about going somewhere and saying, you know, something like, you know, I don't think that people should be, you know, stealing your vehicles and carjacking you and blah, 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 or whatever. Or, you know, standing your ground to a criminal. Nobody would disagree with you. They'd all completely accept you without any sort of persecution whatsoever. So we had common core values. That's just been completely decimated. Totally decimated. So now you have to watch everything you say and who you're around is. I better not say anything because, you know, they're going to, like, want to persecute me. Turn me into the, you know, the probably throw a lawsuit at you for hate speech or something. You know, this kind of severe stuff. Yeah, it's basically, if they don't agree with it, they believe you're guilty of hate speech. So this is not a culture. We don't have a culture. And if you don't have a culture, you don't have a country. You don't have a country. So, you know, but what we do have is we have reasons. That's even better than having a culture or a country. It's even better than that. But if we don't utilize reason, we don't give reason a fair hearing, then we're not going to have anything here. So reason says to save our sanity, to say, nothing to judge, nothing to judge, nothing to judge, yes, yes, yes. Nothing to judge, nothing to judge, nothing to judge, yes, yes, yes. Nothing to judge, nothing to judge, nothing to judge, yes, yes, yes. Just nothing to judge, nothing to judge, nothing to judge, yes, yes, yes. So reason gives us these practices to try and stabilize ourselves in this super persecutional lack of a culture, lack of a country, persecution, a world of persecution now, to save us from that. The reason gives us these practices, and we need more and more help right now, because this is the situation. This is the situation. You know, you gotta be very careful what you say in public at all, who you're talking with. You just like whisper, you know, free, this kind of thing. That's like living hell. You know, we never had to do that kind of stuff. Somebody broke into your home in the past, there'd be 100% condemnation of that. Everyone would support you without any quibble whatsoever. Instead of blaming you or something like that, said that, you know, we don't support that sort of thing in our culture, you know, that kind of thing. Taking something that doesn't belong to you. If it's not yours, don't touch it. You know, if it's not yours, you don't take it, period. So we were brought up with like unequivocal right and wrong. Unequivocal right and wrong in terms of, you know, functioning here. And so everybody agreed with all this stuff. There, nobody would disagree with you. Nobody would disagree with you. If it's not yours, don't take it, period. You don't have to worry about your stuff. Don't have to worry about your stuff. Nowadays, it's absolutely crazy what's going on. So the reason is the option we have. You know, we have this option to listen, give reason a fair hearing. You can do that. It's just a willingness to give it a fair hearing. Let it hear what it says. It's not going to say Trump or Biden or something like that. It's just going to, you know, cue you in that you know, truth is always true and lies can never become true. You know, it'll clue you in that all of this training program ultimately will lead you to recognize this is just a training program we've designed. Of course, logic says God designed all this. That's another big lie. Of course, that'll motivate us to keep slaving away with this training program, won't it? Logic will say, oh, you know, you can't quit this. You know, God created this wonderful universe and created you, this wonderful human body, and you got no choice but this is your life. Lie, 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 lie. God had nothing to do with this, making this training program, nothing to do with making this body, nothing to do with keeping, you know, telling us we're supposed to keep slaving away with this, nothing to do with telling us we're supposed to be happy with this training program. That's all complete total lies by logic. Again, logic will tell any lie at all. It's a complete born liar. You think logic says, gee, I think that's a lie, I better not use that lie, that's a falsity. Oh no, it doesn't think in that way. It says, is this lie helpful? Is this lie, will this lie keep spirit, you know, grinding away, volunteering for this training program? Oh, it will? Okay, great, great lie, this is a helpful lie. That's how logic views it. Is this a helpful lie? This will keep you busy, keep you, you know, volunteering for this training program? Okay, great, it's useful, do it. That's how logic views the situation. It's just what lie is most helpful to keep us grinding away at this training program, to try and develop the ability to destabilize perfection. That's all it is. It's a destabilization training program. That's why everything that is born dies. It gets destabilized. What? Duh. You know, when you see it, it's like the most obvious thing is you can't believe you didn't see that before. Because lies say, oh, this is a wonderful life. You got to make the most of this life. God gave you this life to be happy and blah, 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 blah. He said, wait a minute. Everything that all form that, you know, is born gets destabilized, doesn't it? This plan will be destabilized, you know, not for not. There's a tree over there. It's being gradually destabilized. It's been here my whole life. You know, that tree's been here my entire life. But it's gradually getting destabilized. More and more dead branches, more and more rot, more. Everything's that way here. Everything's being destabilized here. And we believe the lie that logic tells us that this is God's masterpiece. Sure, really? Reason doesn't say that. Reason says that perfection only creates perfection, extends itself as perfection. There's no impermanence or rot or destabilization, whatever, in perfection. None whatsoever. Okay, so, you know, it's like, wow. But again, logic lies in just, you know, with just total what do you say, bravado, you know, it's total bravado with this lie. It'll tell you any lie at all as long as it feels it is useful, you know, useful to keep us volunteering for this training program. Yeah. But so, you know, the key ones are that it says it's a need, it's a need, you need to do this. No, we don't. It's a desire. It's not a need at all. You know, there's no need to do this whatsoever. And then the other one, you can succeed. You'll succeed. Eventually you'll succeed. Total lie. You can't succeed in destabilizing perfection at all. You'll locate a flaw and fix it. There's no flaw to locate or fix at all. Another lie. So you have to sort of undermine these big lies, you know, that logic is telling us, these huge lies, like you need, you know, this is mandatory, this training program. That's really important. That was the key in the revelation I had. That was the key that I was given to success, is to keep harping on this. It's voluntary, not mandatory. Voluntary training program. It's a training program, but it's voluntary, not mandatory. Voluntary, not mandatory. Voluntary, not mandatory. Yes, yes, yes. It's voluntary, not mandatory. Voluntary, not mandatory. Voluntary, not mandatory. Yes, yes, yes. Say that. Just voluntary, not mandatory. Voluntary, not mandatory. Voluntary, not mandatory. Yes, yes, yes. Just voluntary, not mandatory. Voluntary, not mandatory. Voluntary, not mandatory. Yes, yes, yes. Like this. That's key. That's key. So the reason said this is key is a super helpful key, because everything pivots on that. If it's just voluntary, that changes everything, doesn't it? I don't have to be doing this. And then you can really take a look at logic and say, wait a minute, you know. It gives you the leverage you need to recognize what's going on. But if you think you need to do this, you're not going to look too carefully at the whole thing. You say, since I have to do this, I don't want to rock the boat in any way, you know. I got to keep motivating myself to do this. So you won't recognize how all the motivations that logic are using are all lies. They're all lies, because you don't want to lose your motivation thinking you need to do this. But if you realize it's just entirely voluntary, then you're not scared about, you know, recognizing these motivational lies that logic uses. You can start seeing right through them and say, hey, that's a lie. That's not true at all, you know. And you sort of demotivate yourself to volunteer for this. You demotivate yourself to keep volunteering for this futile, you know, training program. This very false hope, you know, glamorous false hope training program, you know, that we've designed. Again, everything is rotting. Being destabilized, dying. That's destabilization. Dying, rotting, sickness, aging, all this stuff. Yeah, kids come in the world and think, oh, you know, it's going to be great, man. I feel so young and fresh and everything like that. Don't they look around? You know, Buddha, the whole story of Buddha was that they were trying to keep him from the knowledge that this world was a place of destabilization. That's the whole story of Buddha, born into a royal family in a royal compound. And they did everything they could do to make him think that there's no destabilization here in this world. Everything's young and fresh and healthy forever. So they had the gardeners working all night long just to remove any dead branches, dead leaves, dead anything, flowers everywhere, you know. Just everything was kept fresh and young and like this, nothing wrong. And so one day he climbed a tree or something and looked over the wall of the compound that he lived in, the royal compound. And they say, well, he saw a beggar, he saw a leper, and he saw a dead person, something like that. You know, the people passing by, you know, he's just like, it's like, what the heck is this? He said, you know. He's like dumbfounded, you know, says, what is going on here? So that moment, he just hit with this tremendous resolve to determine what the heck is really going on here. And so then he left the palace compound and began trying to, you know, does anybody know the truth here? What's going on? And so the meditator said, oh, yeah, if you meditate, you'll find out what's going on. He tried it. And he says, it didn't quite work. Then the ascetics would say, oh, yeah, if you torture the body, you know, starve it and torture it and practice austerities, that'll reveal the truth of what's going on. He tried that. Didn't work either. So then he finally sat underneath the boy tree. He says, I'm not leaving this tree until I finally realize what's really going on here. And then apparently he had a realization, you know, of what's going on here. And he said, the whole universe is just suffering. Yeah. And it's based on desire. Yeah. But then it gets a little murky. You know, where did the desire come from? Like the defiled emotions. Where did the defiled emotions come from? Yes. It's got a little murky, you know, at that point. But this is the situation. Like, you know, I mean, it certainly was a step forward to say, you know, this whole universe is just suffering. That is so true. That is so true. And it's based on desire, which is also true. But what exactly, where did desire come from? You know, they said defiled emotions. Well, yeah, I mean, where it came from was choosing the idea of being prior to perfection, which gave us this intolerable feeling of separation. So that's the quote-unquote defiled emotion that gave rise to desire. So that was not clarified in Buddhism, hasn't been clarified. But we have that clarification now. So that's where desire came from, is we chose the idea of being prior to perfection to see what it would be like, and then we had this intolerable feeling of separation, quote-unquote defiled emotion, you know, it felt completely intolerable. And from there we said, wow, I desire to experience this idea in a glorious way, not in this totally defiled, horrible way. Okay, that's where desire came from. And then from desire came this training program, destabilization training program, which is quote-unquote suffering. The universe is suffering. It's a destabilization training program that we designed. So we've clarified, you know, the whole situation. Now it's not murky anymore. That was why I came into the world, is to just get rid of this murkiness. You know, get rid of this murkiness. Get rid of the murkiness. I don't like the murkiness. And let's make it crystal clear. This is what's going on. So Buddha certainly, I believe he certainly did see, you know, through the situation. It's just has throughout the ages, 25 centuries, you know, there's murkiness there, and people have been trying to work around that in various ways, etc. You know, it gets very complicated and complex, and so much of this and that. But it's better just to remove the murkiness, right? It's better just to remove the murkiness here. So again, this suffering is this destabilization training program that we designed. People say, where did it come from? We designed it. Jesus has said that. We absolutely designed everything here, totally responsible for it. Perfection did not design this at all. It's suffering, destabilization is absolutely suffering. Yeah. It's certainly destabilization is suffering. Came from desire, that's right. Where did desire come from? Again, this defiled emotion, which was really is this feeling of intolerable separation from choosing the idea of being prior to perfection. So it's all very, 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 very clear at this point. Very, very clear. And ultimately, we can accept then that there's nothing to judge here. Equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge. Yes, yes, that's where Buddha must have got to that. And he got to this realizing there's nothing to judge here at all. All suffering is equally futile, you know. So he got to that and then had this feeling of gently gracious equanimity that people felt very strongly. So I believe Buddha did succeed at that, did succeed. And because that equanimity was being felt by everybody really powerfully, powerfully, powerfully. But they didn't really understand very well what the heck was going on. So it became murky, you know, and murkiness has accumulated throughout the ages, you might say. So we cleared out the murkiness of that. No more murkiness at all. None of that, more of that mystery. It's crystal clear here, crystal clear. But that's kind of stressful, you know, because people don't really want it to be. Logic doesn't want it to be clear, right? And logic hates clarity. It loves murkiness. Because then it can generate infinite struggles around that, you know, and infinite stories and infinite scenarios and infinite delay around all that murkiness. Which is what it does, works at. But of course, reason can clear all that up. So we give reason a fair hearing. Reason dissipates the murkiness. It dissipates it for us. Absolutely, it dissipates it for us. Yes, it does. Yes, yes, yes. Supposed to be getting a heat wave here. Eh, not bad. 90, you know, mid-90s. 90, 90, 95, 92, something like that. 3 days, a little mini. It's nice. It's summer. So this is sort of Buddhistic, but a big, huge help from Jesus, to say the least, and Ramaharshi and Sri 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 Anandamayi Ma. But the Buddha saying that this universe is suffering, that's really, really important. That's really, really important. You don't get that in Christianity so much. They try to make it seem like it's God created this. It's a really nice place. You should love this place. So the Buddhists don't have some deity creating this universe. They don't have any such deity. So that's accurate. It was not created by a deity. It was created by spirit, which, we're above deity. That's all deities, which are imaginary, really. But it wasn't perfection. So the Buddhists do not say that God created this universe. They don't say that. In other words, perfection created this universe. So they're accurate about that. That's true. That's true. Very, very important to realize that. And Jesus backs that up in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words and Dialogues on Awakening, etc. He says, perfection had nothing to do with this universe. Doesn't even know that it exists. This training program. Doesn't even pay any attention to it whatsoever. That's our game, so to speak. That's us trying to destabilize perfection. If perfection said, whoa, you better stop doing that, then we think, there must be a way for it to work. Otherwise, why be perfection? We worried about it. So perfection just ignores it. Not worried about it at all. There's no way to destabilize perfection. So the universe is indeed, this training program is indeed just suffering. Came out of desire. Desire came out of this, this terrible feeling of separation, which we wanted to have a glorious experiencing of the idea of being prior to perfection. So this is, and then when you accept that all efforts to train to destabilize perfection, all this training, can never develop the ability to do this. So there's equal futility here. Everyone has equal futility here. Everyone has equal futility here. So equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge, yes, yes, yes. Equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge, yes, yes, yes. Equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge, yes, yes, yes. Just equal futility, zero gradations, nothing to judge, yes, 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 like that. Buddha was a great theorist. Padmasambhava was a great, skillful means. So he was able to meet all different types of people and give them the skillful means to advance, towards giving reason to fair hearing based on their proclivities, based on their habit structures. A lot of the Tibetans back then had vivid imaginations of deities and the interaction of deities and nature spirits, and there's all sorts of drama and stuff in their imagination. Their imaginations were so just extremely active and vivid, and they were doing all sorts of psychic magic and sorcery and all this kind of battles and things, terrible stuff, and a lot of, so they were just beset with this whole vast universe of deities doing all this stuff, kind of stuff. So the Padmasambhava had to use skillful means to help those people like that. But also he helped other people with different proclivities, that's for sure. It's helped me out very, very differently, very differently. He's never, ever mentioned deities to me or anything like that, because I don't have any proclivities towards deities whatsoever. So I must have been Buddhist in some previous lives, I can't quite remember, but I just have no deity proclivity at all, So why would somebody help me struggle, deal with my deity problem or troubles, struggle? No need to. So Padmasambhava is just terrific at skillful means. So he's like the second Buddha, skillful means. And he's not, you know, wedded to any particular skillful means. It's just whatever the people need in any particular place, he's able to help them out and give them, you know, the practices that are effective for them. In different places, different cultural times, etc., require different practices. So he has supposedly pledged to help out successive generations of different cycles and everything like that with different sorts of practices, different means, depending on what that culture is like. So he is active right now. He's helped me out a lot directly in providing skillful means for right here and now. Okay, right here and now. So he's terrific with skillful means. In whatever culture we're living in, you know, this particular culture, big pharma culture, is you know, quite nasty. But all cultures have this great nastiness to them, actually. Our anti-culture, you know, right now is a big pharma anti-culture. They want to get everybody on drugs, for sure. We're carrying out huge marketing campaigns, very clever marketing campaigns to reach that end, that goal. So, you know, we're given reason to fair hearing here. You're hearing this. Is it even possible that we're getting help? Yes, it is possible. Absolutely possible. Ramana said, hey, there's no such thing as getting close to rehabilitating logic, rehabilitating lie, you know, lies, a born liar. It's just as much a born liar as it's ever been, and will always be so. But we can praise and exchange it, because it's not necessary, it's not needed. So it's something that we can, you know, let go. We say, oh, we don't need that anymore, don't need it anymore, don't need it. Just a play of our imagination, creative play of our imagination, right? We're not bound to the creative play of our imagination in attempts to try to learn how to destabilize perfection. We don't have to do that forever now. Don't have to succeed at it now. Yeah. So, yes, indeed. Very great. So here, we've had a good run here. And Yes, too. So again, the super helpful, you can do the say yes. Just do that and just allow this just core feeling there, just to be there, whatever's there. Just allow it there. Don't try to do anything with it. Just keep saying this. And logic cannot get a hold of us when we're saying just yes. Cannot get a hold of us. Okay, so just keep repeating this over and over like this. Just feel, experience it for yourself. It's the only way. You have to have your own experiencing of this. Without logic trying to guide your expectations too much. Just do it and then just say, hey, you know, I just, you know, for a while there, I just didn't feel anything was able to get a hold of my attention like this, right? And that gives us just a brief, you know, breath of perfection, so to speak. Just the tiniest little bit of breathing perfection, which nothing can get a hold of perfection, right? Nothing can destabilize perfection. Can't be destabilized at all. So it's always just this perfect yesing. It's always just this perfect yesing. No destabilization whatsoever. No flaw to locate and fix. Yeah. So all praise to our helpers here. All praise to our friends and helpers here. And may we be completely blessed with praising, exchanging logic for reason, and gently experiencing of gently gracious equanimity. Maybe be blessed with this without any delay. Okay? Without any delay whatsoever. Let's just do it like this instant, so to speak. This instant is just as good as any other instant. All instants are the perfect instant to experience gently gracious equanimity. Absolutely so. Again, all instants are the perfect instants to experience and feel gently gracious equanimity. All instants are the perfect instants. All instants are perfect instants. Yes, yes, yes. 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 To experience gently gracious equanimity. Yes, 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 yes. So, you know, we're in here, but continuing to do our best, even though today has just been real tough day. I think it's the stress and the strain and, of course, the lack of culture in living in a place where you don't have culture. The culture makes things feel very stable, you know, and you'll feel welcome. You know, especially in the Bay Area here, you know, it's like there's a lack of common sense culture here. People are very activist, you might say. And you can't just say, you know what, this let's kind of agree that we don't want to be overrun by criminality, you know, this kind of thing. People, pretty much everyone I talk with agrees, but they're afraid to say anything about it. You know, they're afraid to say anything about it. People will be fired from their jobs, you know, all sorts of stuff. You know, somebody will claim DEI thing. They got that now where people who want to get the power in corporations, et cetera, will, you know, basically will threaten others with blackmailing. I'm saying, well, you said this, you know, that makes me uncomfortable, and I'm being promoted because of DEI, and therefore, you know, you better lay low and let me walk all over you, kind of thing. So people are afraid to say anything now because of the way the corporate DEI, diversity, equity, and inclusivity laws, the corporations have taken them to be law. You know, and they're afraid of being sued. So the whole thing is run off of lawyers, actually, the fear of being sued in the United States. The fear of being sued is what is really pushing all of this stuff. People are terrified of being sued because the settlements are just insane. You know, that they give, let's give them $18 million, you know, because they may have felt uncomfortable or something. I mean, the amount of the lawsuits are designed, you know, to terrify people. It's lawfare. I mean, United States has been destroyed by lawfare. It really has. Just the very, you know, people are terrified of lawsuits. Because who has the money to fight those? Very few people have the money to fight lawsuits. Very, very few. And even those people are losing. I mean, Trump, he's got all the money. You know, he's got, $5-8 billion, supposedly, depending on what his stock is doing. And even he got, you know, railroaded by a kangaroo court, according to a lot of people. It didn't save him, did it? Did it save him from 34 felony convictions? It didn't. So, and not only that, he has more experience than anyone in the court system here. So he has more money and more experience than anyone, and he got lawfared. He got lawfared. Let's just call it like what it is. He got lawfared, okay. So what does that say to the rest of us? We got no chance. We got no chance here. No chance for fairness in this country anymore. No chance. And that's how we feel. So of course we feel despondent. I feel despondent, you know? You just gotta be honest about it. If you realize you feel despondent, why, you know, you won't get so too depressed, hopefully, you know, is you don't have a chance here. You don't have a chance. Do what they tell you to do or else, kind of thing. If you get in the way of people who want to gain power in this world, you know, you're going to pay the price here. You're going to pay the price now. You're going to pay the price. And it's lawfare. And nobody wants to go through that. Nobody wants to go through that at all here. Talk about feeling insecure. The idea of being put through lawfare for anybody in this country is a complete nightmare here. A total nightmare what's going on. And before, we felt everybody get a fair shake, pretty much so. Pretty much so. Not everybody got a fair shake, but pretty much most people felt that they would get a fair shake. And so they weren't concerned about this. Says, look, I just obey the law, you know, don't break the laws, and I'll be fine. You know, these are the laws, very clear. You don't steal property, don't trespass on people's properties, don't steal somebody else's property. You know, this is very simple. Don't harm somebody, you know, physically harm some people or threaten to harm them. That's pretty much the law, you know. I mean, and it's very, very clear and simple. So you felt like, hey, you know, I just obey those laws, I'm fine. I don't have to worry about lawfare at all. Don't have to worry about it at all. Not so anymore. Not so anymore. people could just make a complaint about you, saying they made you, you made them feel uncomfortable or something. They didn't feel so included. They weren't being inclusive enough or something. And they can, you know, throw a lawsuit at you. The company will fire you or something like that. They'll go complain to, you know, the company or something, and you know, you lose your job. That's a type of warfare, you know, lawfare, losing your job because of fear. Company's afraid of being sued. Okay, so the fear of lawsuits of companies is causing them to just be, you know, draconian. But you can do other stuff. I talked to a Gen Zer today. How about that? Gen 17-year-old. I said, tell me, I don't know much about your generation. Tell me, what do you have to say about your generation? He says, we're terrible. So he told me, we're terrible. We're a terrible generation. I was like, why? I said, wow. He said, why? Well, he says, we don't want to work. We're so lazy. Nobody wants to work, my generation. Nobody wants to work. So lazy. Wow. I said, what about drugs? He says, oh, huge amount of drug use, he says. He says, but pot. They're all smoking weed. They're all smoking weed. Gen Z, there's a bunch of potheads. Along with a lot of other drugs, too, you know, but potheads very, very, very severely, he says. He says, we're a terrible generation. Wow. That hurts, you know. I didn't want to hear that. You know, wow, we would certainly love for the Gen Zers to be a great generation. You know, save us, you know. But no, they're smoking pot. What does that do? That distracts us from giving reason a fair hearing. That's logic's way of saying, hey, you know, this is what reason's going to make you feel like anyway. You don't need to give reason a fair hearing because you can just smoke pot and you'll feel, that feeling will be just as if you were giving reason a fair hearing. So no reason to give reason a fair hearing. Just smoke some pot. That's the same. Same difference. Same outcome. That's what logic is telling these kids. And they're making it extremely easy to do so now. And he said, yeah, anybody can get any drug they want to. This is what the Gen Zers have told me. We can get any drug like that right now. No fear of legal repercussions whatsoever. And again, logic saying, hey, there's no, the fast path, take the fast path. Why are you doing slow, you know, spending all these years and even decades giving a fair hearing to reason? He says, the outcome, why don't you just go cut to the chase and go right to the outcome? You want to feel good, right? What's the whole purpose of that? You want to feel good, right? Just take these drugs, you'll feel great. You don't need to listen to reason at all. This is what logic will say. Don't waste all that time. Cut to the chase. Get to that good feeling you want, you're looking for. Here it is. Here's the drug for that. This is what logic is doing to these kids. And they know it. They know it. They don't like it. But they feel like, you know, don't know what to do about it. Well, give reason a fair hearing, kids. Give reason a fair hearing, young people. I was once young, too, and I decided to give reason a fair hearing. I had no choice. I didn't know where else to turn. I knew logic was a total liar, born liar. So I couldn't certainly listen to logic. Yeah, it was going to lie to me again. I said, no way. I want an alternative to logic. Boom. Reason showed up in my life. Everyone has reason just waiting for us to turn to reason and give it.